Trailer's on, popcorn finished, let's play. Someone is about to find out they've won Lotto, but who's the millionaire going to be? Maybe Lisa, who always gets the recliner that doesn't recline. Probably not the guy that's asleep. It was Joe. She'll have to rewatch this on the plane to Florida. Lotto makes 2 millionaires a week on average. Will you be next?
Great stories start with a little spark. A breath of fresh air that can take you away.
You need to let go.
Don't want to let you go.
No, as in let go of me, we're on the ground.
Oh.
Get drawn into the drama on ITVX, the UK's freshest streaming service.
Dating apps are fine, but I am going to have one that eventually matches me with a steak bake. Perfect couple. Back some joy. Greg sponsors comedy on ITVX.
The following program contains immature and adult subject matter. Viewer discretion is advised.
Hi, I'm Steve Martin, and you are watching Just for Laughs.
Just for Laughs, from the funniest city on earth, the Montreal International Comedy Festival. Tonight, Steve Patterson, Mike Birbiglia, hosted by Steve Martin. Just for Laughs 2010. We've kept you laughing for over 28 years.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. These are the Steep Canyon Rangers, whom I will be playing with. I met them in North Carolina. I was on vacation there. I was invited to someone's house, and they said, we have a local band here. And I thought, oh, a local band. How cute. And they came, and they were fantastic, and here we are playing together. That's the true story. That story doesn't go down so well in Hollywood, so there I tell people we met in rehab. I played in Montreal, I'm not kidding, 40 years ago. So there are a lot of familiar faces in the audience. Some of you I'm curiously attracted to, others I am strangely repelled by. But anyway, this first song, it's a song that Rolling Stone called a worthwhile illegal download. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, that was the Steep Canyon Rangers, and I'm very excited because we're recording an album together, which will be released next year, and we already know it's going to be a hit, which is fantastic, because usually you never know, but the reason we know this is going to be a hit, the week of its release, I'm going to die of a Vicodin overdose. So that's pretty good. I am so excited to be hosting the formerly prestigious Just for Laughs Festival. And I tell you, it feels really good to be doing something only for the money. I was a little nervous about hosting this show because there is a lot of responsibility. You have to be funny. And then I remembered that my very good friends, John Cleese and Marty Short, both hosted the festival last year. And I thought, well, I'm funnier than those two idiots. Don't tell him I said that. But every summer, Montreal becomes a comedy mecca. And we all know how funny Mecca is. I'll tell you one thing, though. I love being backstage with all these young, energetic, very talented comedians. And you know, it's taught me something about myself. I'm not very accurate at spitting beyond 5 feet. Actually, I do have a long history with Just for Laughs, so I took a little time to put together a highlight reel of some of my most memorable moments. Steve Martin! So I took a little time to put together a highlight reel of my most memorable moments. Thank you. That brings back a lot of memories.
As an actor, I often get asked what is my favorite role. And I'd have to say, bacon.
Max and Joy, Rex sponsors comedy on ITVX.
With Virgin Media's M250 broadband, go fast. Go lightning fast with our reliable network. Just £29 a month, no setup fee. So why go fast when you can go lightning fast? Virgin Media. See what you can do. Visit virginmedia.com.
I'm starting to think this was a bad idea.
Now you tell me.
I just think we could find something better on Etsy's new gift mode.
What?
Yes, meaning something cowgirly.
Oh, cute. Let me see.
Oh, no, you could take my
cake. What the hell is that?
Happy birthday!
There's people in the cake! It's a people cake!
Don't panic. Gift easy with gift mode. New on Etsy.
It's time to make life a little breezier. Get free Velux app control worth £102 when you upgrade to a new Velux electric or solar-powered roof window. Upgrade today.
This is my kind of town. Chicago is one town. You down. It's my kind of town.
steak bake. Or, as the French like to call it, beef aperitif. Bags and Joy. Greg sponsors comedy on ITVX.
So if the latecomers want to come down now, we promise we will not point you out or embarrass you in any way. This would be, oh, here they come. Yes, yes. You would think that any place discovered by Cartier would have watches that run on time. Oh, are you getting thrown out? Oh, why? Let me see your ticket. Let me see that ticket. Thank you. I am not Cheech and Chong. I think we're ready, don't you think? Our first comedian thinks that going on first is a disadvantage. And the only reason he thinks that is because I told him. Please welcome Orny Adams.
Montreal, summer. Great for my hair. Before this, I was up in wine country. Have you done that before? It's great. You go from vineyard to vineyard with your cup. It's basically trick-or-treating for adults. I was so drunk, at the end of the day, I was knocking on people's houses. They're like, we're not even in a vineyard. I said, I don't care. You got a big backyard. You must be growing something. Let's go fill it up and don't be cheap on the poor. We had fun. My buddy's wife drove because she's having a baby. So now I'm thinking of getting a girl pregnant just so I can have a designated driver. Apparently that's one of the perks, but then you're stuck with one of these kids we have nowadays. These little disrespectful kids, these little shits, these little lazy fat kids. If I was at a high school, they look like thousands of miniature flight attendants just wheeling their... This generation's so fat, this generation's so fat, I swear to God the next war is gonna be for cooking oil. We're gonna invade the canola country wherever, and I think that's Canada. Maybe I wish I was a kid again. I don't like getting older. My forehead is getting bigger, and it's shiny. I'm afraid to get my picture taken. In one picture, I saw a reflection of the guy taking my picture on my... I thought it was an apparition. I go, oh, look, it's the Virgin Mary. They're like, no, that's Bob taking your picture. Thinning and going gray. I used to pluck my grays, but now I need them for filler. Now I use a Sharpie, I just color them in. You ever pluck a gray and miss and get a real one? You're like, damn it! Now I'm losing my eyesight too. Start doing a mini transplant, you're like, get back in there, I need you right there, get back in there. I was gonna take Propecia. There's a pill for hair loss, Propecia. I look into it, one of the side effects is erectile dysfunction. That's more than a side effect. That's more like the effect. It's more like, oh, take Propecia, you lose your erections and you micro hair. The commercial should be like, are you sick and tired of all those unwanted erections? Try Propecia, side effects include hair. But you lose your erections. That's what I need my hair for. This is a team, no quitting you two. Oh, what a great solution. Oh, sorry about my penis, honey, but did you see my hair? This is the best, this is the future for us with hair problems? Future, God, I have enough to worry about with the world falling apart with earthquakes and oil spills and remember global warming? The glaciers are melting. You know, the experts say the Earth's temperature is going to rise 3 degrees in the next 100 years. Well, shouldn't they get the 5-day forecast right first? Shouldn't we know next Tuesday before we start guessing? Remember this whole future? We were all so excited for the year 2000. The future just turns out to be a bunch of crap that breaks. Cable goes out once a week. Did you know that? No, you people work. People like me have to call it in for you. You guys wake up, cable's out. I'll just go to work. It'll be back on when I come home. It's a miracle. I'm the miracle. I'm calling a different country every week. I called last week because I went on a diet. I bought a scale a couple of months ago, right? I bought a scale to weigh myself. I had it for 3 weeks. I get on it. All of a sudden, I weigh error, which is more offensive than my weight. So I call customer service. The first thing they do is they act shocked that their product broke. They're like, our product broke? Meanwhile, you can hear the phones ringing off the hook in the background. Then the guy says to me, he goes, well, did you drop it? Oh, you mean the thing that sits on the floor? Oh, yeah, I'm walking around from room to room to see if I weigh differently, and I dropped it. Oh, and then I kicked it down the stairs and into the pool. It's in the pool. Is it still under warranty? It's in the pool. It's in the pool. It's all wet in the pool. I'm calling a different country every week. And don't you think it's rude that in America, all great, almighty America, we're calling these third world countries with our problems? It's like, hey, I think my high speed's running a little slow. Do you think you can get out of your mud hut and fix that for me? When you're done bathing and urinating in the same water source, you think you could help me out? Oh, I don't think my fridge is working. I've got $300 worth of truffles in there. Can you swat the flies off your face and help me? Oh, I'm sorry. Can you hear me over my central air conditioning? I'm calling from America. Fix my life, damn it. No wonder they hate us all over the world. We're disgusting. I'm nice to customer service because they have all our information. Like OnStar, you see that commercial? The guy they hits a tree and then they call him and talk to him about it? I miss the days of being able to get into an accident and nobody knowing about it. In the commercial, the guy hits a tree, the horn goes, meh. The lady from OnStar comes on, she goes, sir, we noticed you were in a crash. Is everything okay? We've called the police. And I just picture some guy going, no, I'm shit-faced. Don't call the police. We were gonna push it off to the side of the road and sober up. Call Pizza Hut, don't call the police. We were just up in wine country, trick-or-treating. Send a pizza. Sir, we noticed both of your airbags went off. Is your wife okay? That's not my wife!
Thank you very much.
I'm a little rattled. No, it's not about that. It's about these, you know, these Mel Gibson tapes? I just found out that my wife has been taping me. And she is releasing the tapes to the news media. And rather than run away from that, I've decided I'm just going to face it. And right now I'm going to play one of the tapes for you right now. So, please.
So Einstein's initial theory, the special theory of relativity, so upset Newtonian physics. And then, of course, quantum mechanics posed a problem for Einstein theory, and I feel that my job is to resolve that conflict between Einsteinian and quantum mechanics. But first, blow me.
I had had a few drinks and been reading physics books.
As an actor, I often get asked what is my favorite role. And I'd have to say, bacon.
Bags and Joy. Breck sponsors comedy on ITVX.
Why stumble when you can soar? Get super fast, reliable Wi-Fi gliding through every room or £100 back. Virgin Media. See what you can do.
Okay, got you covered.
Boots, with you for life. Get
ready now. Thanks so much for reviewing our shows and movies, Catherine.
No problem. It'll pay for my new pool.
Sorry?
Gross. He thinks he's a cat. Go on then, show me what you got.
Remember this day.
I'm treating this like a murder case.
I'm the king of the weenies!
Hi, Barbie.
Hi, Ken. I love it. All of it.
Now, so much to love. Join in.
Now you can hang frames up to 9 kilos with new Command XL picture hanging strips.
Are you still using your hands when you put on your shoes? Step into the future like I did. With new hands-free Skechers slip-ins, I just step in and they're on. It's like slip-ins have an invisible built-in shoehorn, so my foot slides into place without bending down or touching my shoes. Then the heel pillow technology helps me feel comfy and secure. Experience new Skechers slip-ins.
How is it that when you eat a sausage roll, there's more flakes on the floor than there was in the original sausage roll?
Bag some joy. Craig sponsors comedy on ITVX.
Ladies and gentlemen, you know, in bluegrass music, there's a lot of gospel tunes. And I hear it night after night, you know, because I listen to a lot of bluegrass. And I've realized that religious people have such wonderful music and art, and atheists really have nothing. Until now. This is the entire Atheist Hymnal right here. We're going to sing a little song for you called Atheists Don't Have No Songs.
Christians have their hymns and pages.
Hymns and pages.
Havanagilas for the Jews.
For the Jews.
Baptists have the Rock of Ages.
Rock of Ages.
Atheists just sing the blues. Romantics play Clair de Lune.
Clair de Lune.
Born again, sing he is risen. But no one ever wrote a tune. For godless existentialism.
For atheists,
there's no good news.
They'll never sing
a song of faith.
In their songs,
they have a rule.
The he is always lowercase. The he is always lowercase.
Some folks sing
a Bach cantata.
Bach cantata.
Lutherans get Christmas trees. Atheist songs add up to nada.
Up to nada.
But they do have Sundays free.
Have Sundays free.
Pentecostals sing.
Sing to heaven.
Coptics had the Book of Scrolls. Numerologists count to seven.
Count to seven.
Atheists have rock and roll.
For atheists,
there's no good news.
They'll never sing
a song of faith.
In their songs,
they have a rule.
The he is always lowercase. The he is always lowercase.
Atheist.
Atheist. hymns and pages,
hymns and pages,
Havanagilas for the Jews,
for the Jews.
Baptists have the Rock of Ages,
Rock of Ages.
Atheists just sing the blues.
Catholics dress up for Mass
and listen to Gregorian chants.
Atheists just take a pass,
watch football in their underpants. Watch football in their underpants.
Atheists don't have no song.
Don't have no song.
Oh, ladies and gentlemen, I just got word that our next scheduled act, Richard and His Violent Monkeys, will not be appearing tonight due to a tragedy backstage. You know, when you think of Steve Patterson, two words come to mind: Steve and Patterson. So please welcome Steve Patterson.
Montreal. I think we have something in common. For one, I live in Montreal. And also, I grew up in a house with parents. My dad's from Ireland. My mom is from Quebec. So that's how I grew up. Dad, very friendly, but he liked to always start arguments and fights. Mom always moving to a separate part of the house, trying to call it her own. Still wanted Dad to pay for it, though. I get to travel to Ireland a lot just to see if there are other people in the world like my dad. And it turns out there are. There is an entire country, I don't know if you know this, of very friendly, cheap, shifty people. The Irish are very tricky. They cannot resist the opportunity to trick you. Time of day, perfect chance for a trick in Ireland. I was over there the first time. I didn't know anyone except Irish comics. I don't know if you know this, but comics like to go drinking during the day, and so do Irish people. Their ideal break time is around 2:30 in the afternoon, but the Irish have thought of a new way to say 2:30, just for a trick. He calls me up and goes, "Stephen, we'll meet you at the pub 2:30. And then he hung up. How are you supposed to crack that code? Had to use my basic Canadian math knowledge. Showed up at 1. 2:30 is 1, yes? He didn't show up for an hour and a half. So I had to drink with Irish people in Ireland for an hour and a half, which would be a lot of fun if it wasn't for shifty trick number 2. When you ask for a beer in Ireland, they assume you mean Guinness. That's what they'll give you, a Guinness, which is not even beer. Guinness has its own category. It's called stout, right? What a lot of you might not know is that stout is a Gaelic word that means roast beef. No beer is that color. It's a pint-sized glass of gravy with mashed potatoes on top. That's how thick the gravy is. The potatoes can't penetrate it. It's a nice Sunday meal, but you wouldn't eat 12 Sunday meals in an hour and a half, would you? I was trying to fit in, my new Irish friends. I actually had 12 Guinnesses. 12 guinei, I guess, would be the correct mathematical term. In an hour and a half. True story. Then I realized shifty trick number 3. Irish drinking songs. The Irish have all these drinking songs that we all hear on St. Patrick's Day because they want the world to believe they are fun-loving, musical, lyrical people. And they devoted so much effort into writing these drinking songs. They don't even have the energy left to move their arms when they dance. But as it turns out, that is not why they wrote those songs. They wrote those songs because if you consume 12 Guinness in an hour and a half, there is no way you can speak anymore. But there's a good chance you can slur a song. And the beauty of an Irish drinking song is you do not need to know the words. Nobody does. You get the melody once, sing whatever you want. No one's listening to you. They're all singing their own version of the song. Her eyes, they shine like they're shining. She swore she had pigeons for hands. She had hair all over her shoulders. Come to think of it, she was a man. All right. That'll get you through. I know that I'm not from this country, but I'm very excited as an Irish person that there is another Irish president of the United States, Barack Obama. That is a fantastic Irish leader. That name is practically in an Irish drink. Oh, the boys were getting ready. There was Paddy and Maddie and Tama. The drinks were flowing steady. They were getting right Obama'd. You could fit that in there. No one would question that. In actuality, I guess he's not Irish, but I wish he were Irish. Because if Barack Obama were Irish, he wouldn't have to respond to asinine questions so diplomatically. As it is now, he has to be very diplomatic when people ask him moronic questions. President Obama, what took you so long to respond to the BP oil disaster? He actually has to say, well, that's a good question, Martha. What took me so long? Well, we didn't have all the necessary information at first, resources to devote to this disaster, but as more information and more resources have become available, we are tackling this problem. Now make no mistake, from here on in, I take full responsibility for the response to this disaster. He actually said that. He takes full responsibility. I don't know if black presidents have bigger penises than white presidents. But clearly they have bigger balls. Because that is an incredible statement. Taking full responsibility for something you are in no way responsible for. That is boku de balls. I'm not fluent, sorry. But I would still rather see the Irish Barack Obama respond to that same question, just with seething sarcastic rage. President Obama, what took you so long to respond to the BP oil disaster? What are you, an arsehole? You know I'm the president of the United States, right? I'm the busiest human being on planet Earth. Let's see, what was I doing? First, I spent every waking moment since I was elected pushing through an unprecedented healthcare bill that white people couldn't get through in a trillion years. Then, I had to give several trillion dollars to pompous, selfish, soulless bankers whose heads are so far up their own arse. When they fart, it's a sneeze. Write that down, that's pretty good. I also happen to be in charge of the day-to-day operations of General Motors. In my spare time, I picked up a Nobel Peace Prize for trying to find a solution to a trillion-year-old war. And while we're talking about it, I don't think there is a solution. I think those people like war the same way Canadians like fighting and hockey. I might not like it or understand it, but they do, and I don't have the time to deal with it. So God bless them. And finally, I don't know if you've seen my wife, but she is a fine, sexy, freakishly strong, horny woman. And if I don't give her a taste of the Blarney Stone at least twice a week, nothing, and I mean nothing in this country gets done. So that's why I didn't respond to the BP oil disaster sooner. Yeah. And while we're at it, screw the British. I hate them. First they took part of me ancestors' land, and now they're pissing petroleum all over North America's shores like a kid at the pool. Well, what are we gonna do, President Obama? Nuke them? I say, yes, we can. So ask not what I can do about the BP oil disaster, but what the BP oil disaster can do about itself. Because I know as much about deep sea oil drilling as the last president did about being a competent president. Oh, no, he didn't. Yes, I did. I went there. I said it. Now, are there any more questions? That's what I thought. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going home to the unfortunately named White House to reintroduce the First Lady to the presidential member. God bless America. Peace out.
Boy, if I knew he was going to be that good, I would have canceled him. Our next comedian has been wowing them here at the festival. He has a tough last name to pronounce, so I've been practicing it all day. Birbiglia. 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 So let's please welcome... What's his first name? Mike Birbiglia.
I've been writing this book, you know, and it's sort of painfully true stories from my life. And so I've been calling some people who I grew up with to kind of verify some of the stories. And I called this girl who I had a big crush on in seventh grade named Lisa Bozzetti. And she was way out of my league, you know, but I could make her laugh. You know, she had to talk to me on the phone every night, thanks to alphabetical order, to talk about homework. And one time, I said something that made her laugh. And I was like, this is good, like I gotta do that more. And then one time I said something that made her laugh and she was laughing so hard and she goes, Mike, you gotta stop. I'm gonna pee myself. And I was like, wow. That was the closest I'd ever come to a vagina. So I spent the next 15 years trying to get Lisa Bozzetti to pee. And that's how I ended up here, on stage. And that's how we all ended up here, in a sense. Seventh grade was a really hard year because it was that year where people started making out with each other, and I was just bewildered by this. I remember just being like, people we know are making out with other people we know? But how? You know, it just seemed like this alien ritual where these two aliens kind of attach orifices all of a sudden. I was just like, I am not doing that. And collectively, all the girls in my class were like, that is fine. You're not on the list. But then, you know, it started to kind of split the class up into two distinct groups, kind of the make-out club and the non-make-out club. I mean, these were informal organizations. Of course, that would be very sad. I call this meeting of the non-make-out club to order. First order of business, Nintendo. Second order of business, cures for acne. Third order of business, why doesn't anyone like us? Meeting adjourned. It was a tough group to be a part of because our numbers were dwindling and we were losing good guys by the day. And I feared that soon I would be the lone member of the non-makeout club. And so I was like, I gotta get into the makeout club. But I didn't have any real candidates, you know. Like, I had a big crush on Lisa Bozzetti. And so one time I built up the courage to ask her to go to the carnival with me. And she said yes. And I was really excited in my mind. I had this fantasy, like, you know, it'll be like in a romantic comedy montage, you know, like we'll go to the thing, and then I'll win her a giant stuffed bear, and we'll go on some rides, and then we'll make out, and it'll take like a minute and a half, you know. And we went to the carnival. We went on a ride
called the Scrambler. I don't know if you have the Scrambler here in Canada. I imagine you do. It travels on a truck. You know, it's a very mobile scrambling unit. The premise is that you sit on a two-person pod with the person you're in love with, and then that pod goes in a circle, which is part of an even larger circle, which is part of an even grander circle. As I understand it, it was originally designed as a medical device for constipated patients. It was called the Schitzer Pantserator, and it was very successful, and then it was co-opted by the Carnival Workers of America, QOA, I don't know if you're familiar, and they said, we like it, but we feel like the name is something of a turnoff. And then one guy goes, what about the I think I'm gonna diarator? And they're like, that's good, because it gets across the essence of how you feel when you're on the machine, plus it has the added wordplay with diarrhea, which is a nice homage to the original intention of the machine. But we still feel like the name is something of a turnoff. And then one guy goes, what about the Scrambler? And they're like, nailed it, but who is gonna be in charge of this dangerous piece of equipment? And this one guy goes, well, I have a nephew who's 16 years old and smokes pot 24 hours a day. I feel like he might be available. And they're like, he sounds amazing. We don't even need to interview him. He sounds completely qualified. And so I sit down on the Scrambler, and I know from the moment they put the bar seatbelt down that I am gonna throw up for sure. The bar seatbelt is not a very reassuring piece of safety equipment. That's not a Ralph Nader approved item. That's never saved anyone's life. I think the only thing it's ever done is in a Scrambler accident, it's just kind of held someone's esophagus down to the pavement, making sure that they are dead and that they cannot talk about the Scrambler accident. But I'm still hopeful, you know. I'm like, you know, Lisa's snuggling up to me, and I'm thinking, you know, maybe this is where it's all gonna happen, you know. This is very special. But I think that when you're 12 years old, you just don't understand certain things about the digestive system. Like, you don't know that you shouldn't eat popcorn and peanuts and funnel cake and cotton candy, and then go on a machine that scrambles your body. Cotton candy being the most insane of these items. It's basically like saying, we're gonna take sugar, which everyone knows is bad, but then we'll dress it up like insulation. And I'm like, I'm not sure what the selling point is there. Is it the sugar or the insulation? I'm like, we already sold it. So I know they put the bar seatbelt down, I'm gonna throw up. And I even say to the 16-year-old stoner, I'm like, hey, actually, and then he was gone. Apparently, he doesn't enjoy the second halves of sentences. And so then I'm scrambling, and I'm thinking, I need to come up with a plan of some kind. And my first plan was that I just wouldn't look at Lisa and I wouldn't look at any other people. So I'm like, don't look at Lisa, don't look at any other people. Don't look at Lisa, don't look at any other people. I need a new plan. And the new plan was that I needed to tell the Scrambler operator that he needed to stop the ride. But the mathematics of the Scrambler are such that the window of opportunity in which one can communicate with the Scrambler operator is a very limited window. So I'm like, I gotta tell the guy to stop the ride. I gotta tell the guy to stop the ride. I gotta tell the guy to stop the ride. Please stop the ride, and then I'm back. The third time I said, please stop the, and then I started throwing up. And it was not unlike an oscillating lawn sprinkler. Just popcorn and peanuts and insulation. Really insulating the pavement with my homemade carnival salsa. And I did not look at Lisa, but I'm pretty sure she was staring at me. And we did not make out. I did not lose my mouth virginity that evening. But I called Lisa, you know, like as an adult and everything. And I'm telling her this story, and she's laughing, you know, and it's really exciting to have this moment where we're laughing. And I'm not sure, but I'd like to think that she peed herself. Thanks, Montreal.
Just as a reminder, I'm sure you realize that tonight's show is not a contest. However, the score is 6-3. Thank you very much for inviting me here tonight. It's going to be a long time before I forget this festival, but believe me when I tell you, I will forget it. So please give a big round of applause for tonight's performers, Mike Birbiglia, Steve Patterson, Orny Adams, and Steep Canyon Rangers, ladies and gentlemen.
That's it for now. Thanks for joining us on Just for Laughs. Now the credits are going to roll. We don't really expect you to stick around for this, but I have to. We'd appreciate it if you did. There's my name. Woohoo! The fifth cameraman is hot. Okay, then, I'm done. Can I go now? Oh, for crying out loud. What now?
vegan sausage roll.
I think they'll make a meat version soon, you know.
Oh, come on.
A good one.
Back some joy. Greg sponsors comedy on ITVX.
With Virgin Media's M250 broadband, go fast. Go lightning fast with our reliable network. Just £29 a month, no setup fee. So why go fast when you can go lightning fast? Virgin Media. See what you can do. Visit virginmedia.com.
Shop Etsy until April the 15th and save big on thoughtful pieces made by real people to brighten your home. Get extraordinary items that complement your style and help bring your vision to life. Order until April the 15th for incredible savings on lighting, furniture, gifts, and more. When you need just the thing to make your space feel like new, Etsy has it.
We gotta get ready
for our family migration!
From Illumination, the creators of Minions.
I can't believe it!
Watch at home or on the go.
Guys, you have to see something. It's incredible.
Anytime, anywhere.
Just stick close to me, and everything will be all right.
Maybe don't stick too close.
Migration. Buy or rent at home.
Customer satisfaction results are in.
Are we here or...
All right, yes, all right, I understand.
Perhaps we could try being more like Nationwide.
Like Nationwide? What are they doing now?
They tell their customers if better savings rates are available. Been doing it for years.
Soon our customers will be asking for it too.
They already are.
Muffin me.
This person can't even spell banker.
It's not banker.
Oh.
With Nationwide Savings Watch, we'll tell you when we have new savings accounts or better rates. Nationwide, a good way to bank.